appreciate everybody coming in. So I hope everybody has been signed in first and gotten kind of a method for a madness here today. Once you sign in, you get a grand report. Because people ask me, what does the organization do? Well, it's very clear when you get a report for what we've done for the last many years. And we have pictures on the inside of what we did for this year. And then we have complimentary awards that the organization's giving, and we ask people if you're interested to do best wishes to the honorees up here on this table here. If you missed that when you came in, and you know, it doesn't have to be your entity, but you can do somebody else's entity, because again, this is all about community, and part being part of community, you want to work with everybody, and everybody should be understanding what the various groups are that are in San Francisco. Unfortunately, we had a scheduled MC that's the last minute canceled out, so now I have to do double time. So I'm the executive director. My name is Michael Nolte, and our organization is today celebrating our 17th annual gathering and also proceeds to this award ceremony. And we are glad to get started. So the first thing I want to call attention to is, well, first I guess we do introductions. I want to point out our board members. Marvis Phillips, our land use chair. Susan Bryant, our treasurer. And biographer. Dennis up here is our administrative assistant and administrative officer. And we have Otto, who's on the board. And okay, some of the other faces are not here yet. First thing is, we have so many meetings we wanted to put together. We have set of ground rules that's on page right here, sitting next to the white sheet paper. I believe everybody does. So basically, when I emailed everybody about the award ceremony, you got to see there's a whole section there about what we expect of you for the procedures award ceremony, because that way everybody's on the same page. So I'll just read it real quick. Your honorees will be given 2 minutes to speak. We'll have time to well and tell each other if you take too long. Your award will be read aloud, and you'll shake hands with the presenter. We have cameras, close to the cameras, and then you're given an opportunity to speak. Part of our ground rules, we just don't like people, this has happened before, we don't want people booing or hissing at the speakers or anything else, because we're videotaping this, it's going to go from YouTube, and it's happened before, and I mean, that's not what this is about, so hold to yourself. So, we're going to have door prizes. We have food. Again, there's a little information about that. And
supposed to be tickets given out at the door?
No, there'll be, because people leave, so those will be given out to the people who are here afterwards. Because and we have many door prizes, so I think I could say that everybody in this room will probably get one of those, hopefully. So, well, you get a ticket for sure. And that's our part. That's also part of our rounds. If you leave and you get you got a ticket in your hand, you can give it to somebody else so they can win the prize for you. Because it's you call a number and then nobody's here. That's kind of like also wanted to ask is the person from Jake Kim's office here? Okay. Let's see how good I decided to ask. All right, so we're going to get into this. So our first thing will be, we will have our keynote speaker speak about the public defender office, and then we'll warm up into our public defender, Jeff Dodge.
Well, thank you very much. I'm honored to be here. I wouldn't be called a warm-up act, right? it's such an honor to be here. Acknowledge and congratulate all of the honorees who have worked hard to support the community. You know, when I did the TL, I always feel like I'm at home. Although I grew up in Sacramento, I came to San Francisco in 1985, and I was in the TL. I was talking to the chief financial officer, UC Hastings, where I went to law school. And I lived in Towers. We actually have a 13th floor there, so I lived at 1305. And back then, rent was $305.
We also provide representation to all young people. There's about 1,000.
to trouble with the juvenile justice system. So I have the staff of YGC, youth guidance center that provides support here. So if you ever know anybody who's in trouble or needs help, public defense kind of person to talk to. Let me just tell you a story tonight about a case that I just completed. I still try cases, I'm proud of it. It's just like what you see on TV. We're in court, we try cases, opening statements, closing arguments, cross-examining witnesses. But it's a case that really took me back home because I represented a 31-year-old Cambodian woman who grew up here in the Tenderloin. For murder. She was charged with murder. She had never been in trouble for her entire life, ever. She had had a stable job, a stable relationship, and when she broke up with the person that she was with, she started dating somebody new that she met up on a dating website, and you know, they ended up having a relationship together. She was accused of stabbing him, of killing him in a Tenderloin. But she was right here in Tenderloin, and she was charged with first-degree murder. And it was a self-defense case, but the police never told her before they interrogated her, or questioned her, that her boyfriend had died. And so she basically told them it was all her fault that she killed him, or that she stabbed him on purpose, right? Thinking that he was alive. She didn't want him to get in trouble for attacking her. And she was just in this terrible situation where she was charged the first murder.
She read her Miranda
rights? Well, yeah, she was read her Miranda rights. And she didn't have our statement. You know, so that's what we were fighting against in that case. And she had she has a 10-year-old daughter, right, who lives in the TL. Her family immigrated from Cambodia you know, in the 1980s. They came here in 1983. And so, you know, she grew up here and struggled here with the school, with Galileo High School, and you know, pretty much lived a good life until this thing happened. And so, of course, they had no money to hire a lawyer, and so I became her public defender. So, for 16 months, we fought her case. We went all the way to a jury trial, and it culminated in a 9-week trial, and she was acquitted. At the end of the trial, the jury found her not guilty and allowed her to go home to her family. And she loved this person that she was with, and that was still part of what we tried to communicate to the jury, that she would not have wanted to hurt him, and that she acted in self-defense in a situation he was addicted to drugs, and unfortunately attacked her, and she defended herself. But you know, that's the kind of situation that most of us could never imagine being as good as you might see a TV. But things like that happen to people, where people wind up in situations where they have no one to help them and they're against the system. And as public defenders, what we do is represent individuals, right? And so I was able to bring in experts to the case. Right? This is going to sound kind of crazy, but they had experts that were not off the phone where she was making statements, like, I'm going to stab this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. And so they said that that was evidence that she intended to kill him. Well, if you look at the urban vocabulary and vernacular, stabbing is something else. I won't tell you what it is. Something very different. And so we called a urban dictionary expert. This guy had written two dictionaries on slang. And so we testified as to what the meaning of stab was. And it was something very different.
What is it?
You can look it up. Also, the medical examiner in the case, who did the autopsy, testified that there are all these stab wounds on him that she was responsible for. It turned out that those stab wounds were from what they call medical therapy when they're trying to render aid to him, trying to save his life. And again, when you get in that situation and someone says, hey, you're responsible for this, and in fact you did, who are you going to call? That's what we're going to do. The time that I've been in office, I've tried to pride myself on running the best public defender's office in the country. To me, what that means is that we not only care for the individual, but we care for their family. We have, for example, the Children with Regards for Parents program, so if a parent is in custody, appropriate circumstances had allowed my client to see her daughter maybe once a month before they were reunited. And, you know, to really have a holistic approach to supporting our youth. And I know we work with the Youth Development Center, who's here, and other groups within this community that have provided that sort of support. We've also played a very active role in exposing police misconduct in the community. If you recall, at the Henry Hotel on 6th Street, we had numerous reports that police were violating people's constitutional rights by going into the room without search warrants. But you have to have a warrant. And so we sent an investigator there. We got them within a year and a half with the video team. And it turned out the police were not only going into people's rooms without a warrant, but they were also stealing the property. And so we called for a federal investigation. And as a result of that, five police officers were convicted of court are violating constitutional rights as well as staff. And so, you know, you would not need the public defender's office to play a role in those kinds of cases. You know, we think it's very important that when things like that happen, that there be the public accountability. So I'm very proud of my staff. They're very hardworking. If you ever need our support, I know most people say, I hope we never need your support. But if you're ever interested in coming to visit our office and come down to the court and see what we do, then we'd love to have you. We have a court watch program where we invite students and even adults to come and watch court, give you a little tour. We call it the Hall of Justice, but at 850 Bryant Street. You know, we do a lot of community forums and programs, and so we're very interested in participating and learning about the work that we do in the courts. Please let me know. I want to give a special thank you to the Multi Brothers and to the Alliance. When I ran for office, it was very well known. I had done a lot of work at the trial bar, but was not known in political circles. And I was running against a very powerful person who was running against me. And the first organization that supported me was the Alliance. I was elected in 2002. I've been a public defender now for, it's been 29 years. But I've been the public defender in the city and county now for 13 years. And it's really a job that I love and I'm excited about. And it's fun. It's really a lot of fun being a public defender, being fighting for social justice issues. Right now is a very exciting time, right, with Black Lives Matter, with racial justice reform, criminal justice reform, you know, talking about around the country. We have a racial justice committee in our office, and we're actively involved in litigating these issues. That means raising these issues in court, in bail motions, in sentencing, and trying to make it a more just society. So that's very exciting about being part of that change. And I know the Alliance has been a big part of that change. But I know this is like the Academy Awards. You said we can stop playing music. But please know you always have my support. If there's anything I can do to help you.
Across the bay, and chased this white man who I think had stolen a car or